Good morning, dear LIBS enthusiasts. This first short course will be devoted to a topic which is particularly important in LIBS, which is quantification of unknown samples composition, which can be done, we know, in many different ways, and this topic will be developed in the next, let me say, 20 minutes. I will try to be very short. First of all, because we have a contest which is running, although the submission now have been closed and will be discussed on Friday in a specific session in which we will determine which kind of performance we can expect from LIBS analysis on a series of rather complex samples. We will discuss in a moment. And the second, because at the moment of this the recording of this presentation, I don't know anything about the results of this contest, so I will not spoil any specific result or something that can be considered as a spoiling of the final discussion that we will have on Friday, next Friday, in Bari. Well, the problem of quantification has been faced several times at LIBS conferences, so with the idea of firstly of distributing samples between the participants, and then making the LIBS analysis and submitting the results. This was done for the first time in Canada, in the fourth LIBS conference, if I'm not wrong, under the supervision of Professor Mohamed Sassabi, and we did with alum samples, and then we repeat the contest in Berlin, using steel samples and under the supervision of Professor Banner from BEM. And then we had in recent time in Chamonix another contest using samples of cast iron. Then a nice idea occurred to our French colleague, based on consideration which is completely shareable, is that the problem of acquiring LIBS or relatively good LIBS spectrum is not a very big problem nowadays. The problem is the analysis of the data. So a good solution to the problem of distributing a large quantity of samples, which was not trivial in the previous conference, was to distribute the spectra instead of the samples. So someone has to be in charge to produce the spectra with a good instrument, of course, and with all the experience of many, many years of work in LIBS. And then we can discuss on the methods used for quantification instead of the way in which this spectra can be acquired, which is important, but is not, from the experience of our French colleagues, not the most important problem. So we have still to develop a procedure for making quantitative analysis by LIBS, which can be in some sense standardized. And this is very difficult because LIBS can be applied to many different materials. So in 2019, in Brno, the colleague from the Czech group did a very interesting proposal to share spectrum, the organized constant on contest on classification using LIBS. It's an important for the problem indeed. And now, in this conference, we are trying to do the same distributed spectra for quantification. Again, I would not spoil anything about the results. I'm participating unofficially, of course, and I'm not competing. And I'm exactly as all the other participants, I'm not aware of the results, if not in general terms that I have submitted my results to the organizers of this contest, which are myself and the group from Brno. I will just give you a simple reduce my sides of my face to give room to the real information. So this is the call that we have had on the LIBS site to the contest. The deadline is over, so we can discuss without any problem about the in general terms of this contest. So I invite you to go to the LIBS site, if you're not already done, to see the call and learn a little bit more about the sample. So we had for you, I've downloaded the README of the conference, which says of the contest, which says that we have information about 42 standards of steel, so iron-based materials, in which we had to predict the concentration of chromium, manganese, molybdenum, and nickel in 15 unknown samples of the same kind. It's difficult to say in this case the same matrix, because the matrix could be very different according to the composition and the concentration of these four elements. So in general, we have iron-based materials, but the concentration of iron can change dramatically. Well, we have, you will see in the site, there are two sets of data, which are the set of data on the 42 standards and the set of spectra, and the set of spectra on the 15 unknown metal alloys or spectra from metal alloys. For each standard, each unknown, we have 50 spectra taken according to this procedure, which is an advanced system, which has provided us with about 40,000 spectral element per spectrum. And this is one of the problems of this contest, is the large amount of data that LIBS is capable to get, to obtain. So we have 40,000 spectral information per spectrum, 50 spectra per sample, and in total 42 samples as standards and 15 samples as unknown. So it's a very large amount of data. There are some details on the way in which the spectra are being recorded by our colleague in Brno, with 1.5 microsecond delay and 50 microsecond gate. The colleague which got the spectrum precised that the spectra are not intensely calibrated, and the long gate width is a part of the challenge. So this is a configuration, for example, which make very difficult, practically not applicable, the calibration-free strategy. So this part of the difficulty of the challenges that we are forced to use the 42 standards as for building calibration curve or calibration surface, or using all the statistical methods that we have to obtain. Well, it's interesting to note that the authors are not the authors, the organizers or the colleagues from Brunel didn't specify whether the concentration that are provided are concentration in weight or concentration in number. This is another difficulty, because we know that LIBS is in ideal condition provides a result which is linearly dependent on the number concentration of the elements, and when the basics change dramatically, the weight concentration can produce non-linearity which occurs even in the case of otherwise linear behavior. This is a point which is important to understand. We don't have this information, so we have to assume that we will make our analysis on samples in which the numbers can represent either the weight concentration or the number concentration. We don't know. So this is part of the test. You will see, and I strongly suggest if you didn't do, to download the spectra actually and test your system, even if you will not participate to the contest as I did at the end, just to understand the difficulty of the problem while discussing. So you can, if you like, pause the video, download the data, take a look at the data, then if you like, we can continue. If you have already done, we will proceed. I will tell you just in advance warning that we have two sets of data. The original set of data that was loaded by our colleague in Brno at the start and the beginning of the contest, and then we stick with that because this was the most difficult data set to analyze, and then we have a raw data set which is containing the same spectra but with additional information, for example the concentration of the other elements. So I strongly suggest you, if you would like to test if you have not already done, if you like to test your skills in quantification, to use the original data set, not the raw data set with the minimal information needed for the quantitative analysis, which is the concentration of chrome, manganese, molybdenum, and nickel on the 42 reference samples. So, what we can do for starting? Well, the first thing to do is in quantitative analysis is taking a look at the data. So, I made this table and choose among the 42 samples the one which shows the maximum and minimum concentration of the given elements. For example, sample reference sample number 12 has the minimum concentration among all the other of chromium, while sample 39 has the maximum concentration of chromium, 27.16, whatever weight percent or number percent we don't. And the same for the other elements. Why I'm suggesting to take a look at this extreme? Because we have a very large amount of data. So we have a quantity of data which is huge, and we cannot treat it or using all the information that we have in our samples, because even with the most advanced statistical analysis, the quantity of data will be overwhelming, so it will be very difficult to do the analysis. So there are two approaches. The automatic approach is to use algorithms for extracting future selection the spectral data which are more significant for the analysis, or, and I'm sorry, but I will always prefer the second way, to take a look at the spectra and select the spectral region which are more significant according to our experience. Just, we know where we expect to have the emission of chromium, manganese, molybdenum, nickel, and so on. We can do this calculation, this analysis, and this selection without any recourse to automatic systems that will be difficult to check. The most important thing is having a control of your algorithm, which is extremely difficult if you start using complex algorithms which very quickly make that you lose the contact with the reality of the data. So let's see, for example, the chromium line. I've extracted from the data set the spectra corresponding to these samples and made an average of the spectra just to have a quick idea of the area of the spectra, and I can load on whatever system. I can use, for example, our LIBS++ software, but there are many other possibilities, and we'll load, try to load to load the corresponding spectra. For example, for chromium, I don't remember exactly where it was. Well, chromium, we said maximum 39, maximum concentration, sample 39, minimum concentration, sample 12. So I will load spectrum 12, spectrum 39. We can compare the two spectra all together. And 12 will be in black, and the 39 will be in red. So we are looking for spectral features that are prominent in spectrum number 39 and will not be almost absent in sample 12. It's not automatic that will occur easily because we have the several elements in our samples, but let's see. So we can look for the chromium line, for example, and check whether this chromium line are indeed prominent in sample 39 with respect to sample 12. And we see, for example, this spectral region, we see that we have several lines from chromium which are prominent with respect to the lines of the same elements in the lower concentration sample. So, for example, this spectral region can be interesting for our analysis. Let's check the correspondence of the theoretical emission. This is the experimental one. We have a slight shift in the wavelengths, but this is not a problem for us. So it's the wavelength will not be important in our analysis if not for locating the lines that are interesting for us. These are other lines of chromium 1, which are prominent in spectrum 39 and not prominent in spectrum 12, as we expected. So this is another region that will be interesting, and so on and so on. So we can select some region, I tell you, not just the peaks. Do, of course, we can select the peaks, that will be a longer procedure. So we would like to have at the end a system which is also fast, is not only efficient. So in this way, we can select the spectral region of chromium, we can select the spectral region of the other element, just comparing the spectra in which we expect to have this element at larger concentration or lower concentration. Second step that we can do, I will not show because this is a part of the discussion that we will have on Friday when we will announce the three best performers of the this contest. Next thing to do is to check that at least qualitatively the standards correspond to the concentration. This can be done very quickly using just taking one line, the prominent line, trying to build quickly a calibration curve using with this line. It can be noisy, it can be non-linear, it would be noisy, it would be not linear for sure, but we will start to see how is the phase of our samples. And if we do this, we can have some surprise and discuss in on Friday. I will not anticipate anything, but a quick check on univariate calibration curve using the most prominent line of the element, the sample of which we have the samples, which we have these elements, which are all of them, will be important. Okay, so now we have a small region in which we can apply our data. So for the analysis, I applied, this is my approach, I cannot tell is the best approach, and probably my result will not be, though they are out of concourse, of course, out of contest, will not, I'm not participating to the contest officially. So this is my approach. It's just a suggestion, and then for sure the groups which have obtained the best result and use more advanced approaches, but this is not really the point of this tutorial. The point is just to show you a workflow in which we can move. So the first thing that we can do is using this spectral region that we have just selected to select our inputs, and using a statistical approach. As a general approach, there are many, of course, we can also make some comparison if we like. But as a general approach, I generally select artificial neural networks because they can deal very easily with linear and non-linear behaviors. The problem of the neural networks, as most of the statistical and analytical approach, is that they are prone to overfitting. Overfitting means that you can be very good in reproducing the concentration of the standards with your statistical model, and then the statistical model will be absolutely wrong or not usable on the unknown. It's just overfitting. Can the problem of overfitting as an immediate comparison with the problem in linear analysis of fitting a series of data with a polynomial function which has the same dimension or even higher of your data. So you can fit perfectly your data, but your model will be good only, and probably not very good even in this case, for interpolating, for interpreting your data from the training set and not for determining the concentration of the unknown. So just for a quick or a demonstration, not really important. I use a trick that was introduced indeed by our colleague from Czech Republic. It's used in many other techniques. It was introduced in LIBS, which is the bootstrap meter. The bootstrap meter means, is applied, taking from your set of data the average of a group, normally three or four spectra, and choosing randomly the elements that you use for making this this average. Since we have 50 spectra and we are considering combination of these spectra in groups of, let me see, three in this case, as an average, you have a consistent number of independent realizations that you can build. And I just choose to make it or use a factor of two amplification of our data. So instead of adding 50 spectra per sample, with this bootstrap method, I incremented with a factor of two the number of spectra, and at the same time, since I'm using averages, I'm reducing the variability of the data. This kind of averaging is done on set of spectra of the same samples, so in principle, there should not be any variation in the natural variability of the LIBS analysis, and this is reduced when I think. So the bootstrap method is very interesting in LIBS specifically, and I use it just for demonstration purposes. At the end, 50 spectra per sample and 42 samples will be more enough for avoiding overfitting, but this is what we have. So I will extract let's use Chrome as an element. So I will extract from my data set the spectral region in my sample, and then this will be the inputs, and the concentration will be our outputs. In my approach, I used four different models for the four elements, but we can also, it's more complex and even to manage. We can use a single model for the concentration for all the elements in our sample. So I extracted this, and I'm using MATLAB for the analysis because it's a commercial software, but most of the universities or research centers have conventions with MATLAB getting for free from the University of Pisa, for example. But exactly the same algorithm you can have in completely free software as R, which is very powerful. Never really went in depth with this software, but I know that you can do exactly the same thing that you can do with MATLAB, and you can do it for free. But I will show you MATLAB for another reason. We have this regression learner package in MATLAB, which is in some sense is kind of debunking of many papers in which you can see complex comparison of one model with respect to another. So this kind of comparison can be done just with a click of mouse with MATLAB. So it's not research at the end. So If you have a problem and you have a model which solves this problem, okay, that's fine. But there is really a plethora of papers in which the only result, quote, is the comparison of different models, standard models that you can do in 5 minutes with MATLAB. Let's consider what is really a spectrochemical analysis and what is just an exercise of statistical. So I will not show you this exercise, I will show you just the analysis from the data that we have selected using an artificial neural network. So my set of data is Chrome, these are the inputs of my data, and the concentrations correspond to the same samples are in this CC variables. So we start the session. You will see most of the troubles are already taken in charge by MATLAB. For example, you can set a five-fold cross-validation, which is in general for this size of data is considered appropriate. Cross-validation means, five-fold cross-validation means that you are splitting your spectra in five groups, and you use one of these groups for validation, and the rest, the other four, for 80%, let me say, for building the model, and 20% for testing this model. And then you are rotating n-fold cross validation. N can have all the values, but if your number n is 5, we have 80%, 20%. If n is equivalent to the number of samples, you have the so-called Lee one out model, in which you take one of the samples apart, and then you use all the other for building the model, and then you make a validation changing the one that removed. So you are not mixing the test and validation for this kind of analysis. And then we can start our session. Okay. So we have a list of model. I don't know why MATLAB is using as default a decision tree that is always there at the beginning, but we will not use it. And we have a list of the possible models that we can use. And you see, again, if you would like to make as many, unfortunately, we are doing a comparison paper, just choose three or four of these of these possible algorithms, and then you determine that one has 90% efficiency, the other one 90.5, and then 90.5 is better than 90, and that's over. It's not the way in which it works in general, so be aware that in LIBS we should always thinking about really spectrochemical problems, not computational problems like that, especially when the algorithms or the methods are very, very standard, you find preset in this system. Okay, so we have 1,240 inputs and one output. We had to set our neural network again. Probably, for sure, all these features are not really necessary for the analysis. We just taken portion of the spectrum without thinking specifically whether in this portion we have our element for line for sure, but we don't know. There will be other lines not correlated to our results, noise, and so on. So the one thing that we can do is using a principal component analysis, which will reduce the number of samples. So you can, in MATLAB, you can specify the variance, so how faithful your model is, your PCA is to the total data. If you specify 100%, you will have the same number of variables, not to use any, you will not get any advantages, or you can specify the number of components, which is from a maximum of 124, let's go to 50. 50 will correspond roughly to 98.5-99% of explanation of the variance, and we reduce substantially the number of inputs. And always consider the problem of overfitting. If your variables, your inputs are too many, you can have this overfit. So we will save and apply these things, and then without too much problems, and we go to the neural network, neural network, in this case, no need for using deep learning or other complex systems. So we can set, let me say, 50. We have 50 inputs, so we use 50 neurons in the hidden layer. We can use an activation function of the sigmoid type, and then no regularization, standardization from the data, and so on. So, just a quick reminder of how the neural network works. In the neural network, we have a set of inputs which are linearly combined at least this back propagation feed forward. Neural network, which is more or less what we need in this case. So we have a set of input that are linearly combined between them, and then sent to a set of neurons that are not interacting one with the other in the hidden layer. These neurons can do something. So if they are doing nothing, just taking the linear combination and moving it to the output, we will have a linear approach. So we will not introduce any non-linearity in the relation between the inputs and the output. The output in this case is the concentration of chrome in our side. So this is a reasonable approach, but probably we don't need an artificial neural network for doing a linear multivariate analysis. For doing non-linear multivariate analysis, this linear combination in each neuron is partly treated with a non-linear function, which can be a hyperbolic tangent, a sigmoid, at the end, what we would like to do is introduce a non-linearity, and sigmoid, for example, is good, because in a sigma-shaped fashion, we have an initial exponential region, then we have a linear region, and then we have an exponential saturation part, and these three parts correspond to three nonlinearities that you can have in your set of data. So exponential increasing, linear and saturation, so exponentially saturated to a a given value. So according to the linear combination, you can introduce this non-linearity, and then combining all the output of these neurons all together to get the output. How it works, the optimization of the model, you have a starting combination, linear combination of your data, you apply the nonlinearity, and you predict through the combination the output. The output is the concentration, again in this case, and we compare this concentration with nominal data. So for each sample, we apply the same model and we say, okay, we are expecting a concentration of 10%, and we get a concentration of 80%. Not good. We have to change the coefficient of the model, an efficient algorithm, not just taking random numbers, but looking for the change of the parameters in the model, which are moving you towards a good matching between your nominal concentration, which are your reference, and the prediction of the network. So this is a feedback back propagation in which the result is used as a feedback for improving the model. It works the same way in linear multivariate analysis and non-linear multivariate analysis, like artificial neural network. You have the same with the introduction of the non-linearity from the activation layer. So you can choose non, and you will have a linear approach. So we can start the training of our model. It will take some seconds. We will also train the tree, the decision tree. Again, I don't know why it's used as a default. It's not the most appropriate, and you see, in fact, this is the comparison of the true values for the tree and the predicted value. So you see, you are expecting this concentration for the samples, and working on that, and we get a rather noisy result with a root mean square of the error on the validation set of 1.38%. Whatever this percent is, the same dimension of the concentration in weight or in number, we don't know. So this is the tree, and this is the neural network. You see, the neural network is much more better. We have 0.4 error. Root mean square error on the validation of 0.4. Again, this is the true concentration, the predicted is not bad. And you see that the prediction is not perfect because we have 50, no, really 100 now with the bootstrap meter, 100 spectrum per sample, and so we have a kind of distribution. Now, we can export our model, the training model Chromium. Okay. And we will apply this model to our unknown samples, and this will give our final results in terms of average values and standard deviation. So just for curiosity, I can open origin for plotting our data. But we can use MATLAB the same. Just I'm working in using a different software per each problem. So these are the training data. These are the common unknown data. And for example, I run different models just to check whether the results are reasonable or not. You can plot these results. And what appear the concentration of chromium, concentration, the units are in terms of the unknown sample number. So we have the concentration for sample 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and with variability which corresponds to the variability of the prediction of the 100 spectra, also for the unknown samples you can use the bootstrapped. It's important so we will have the same procedure. This is the end of the evaluation. You can do the same for manganese, molybdenum, nickel, and chromium already done. So it's very easy as a procedure. Not say that this is the way for obtaining the best, most precise result in the world, but you can have an idea of what is going on. After that, if you would like to make some exercise, for example, you can use a quadratic support vector machine, which are very fashionable in this time. You can train on the same data the support vector machine, and we'll see whether we will have the same root mean square error or similar neural network or something different. Yes, you see, in this case the result is more noisy with respect to the neural network. It's not optimized at the end. Or we can use dry the trees because I don't like it. At the end, the regression trees, a lot of application using random forest and so on. Sometimes they work, sometimes they work less efficiently and so on. So, but again, this is not the topic of the contest, just to compare different approach. And we have a very robust and solid approach, which is artificial neural network. We can start with that. Then maybe we can obtain some slightly better result. I don't know, much better with other approach on Friday. Really curious to see how better this model is performing to the other, but the idea of this tutorial was just to show you one of the many possible route to obtain a quantification from our complex data, and then I show you for chromium, but I have done for the other, for the rest of the elements. So I hope this was interesting for you, and I give you an appointment to Friday morning when we will have the session discussing this result. It will be very interesting to talk together. Meanwhile, if you like, you can work on the sample. Again, use please the original data, not the raw data, because these are the most complex and most challenging set of data. Is significant the result compared to the use of the other system. Okay, see you soon on Friday in presence, I hope, in Bari, or